Good morning, friends. Matt Greer here. Welcome to Monday Morning Music with Matt here at St. John's United Methodist Church in Albuquerque, New Mexico. That was The Hudson by Ola Yalo, performed by Joel Bechtel and Amy Greer. And what a beautiful way to start Monday morning. That was filmed in our choir room right at the beginning of lockdown, one of those dozens of Music from St. John's videos that we produced as a way of continuing to get music out to the community when people couldn't come here to hear music and also give work to local musicians. I played that this morning because one of the things that's going on this week is on Thursday, we have a live stream noon concert. I hope you've been aware that we have been producing live stream concerts from our sanctuary most Thursdays in October and November. And the last one on this series is this Thursday at noon and will feature those two musicians you just heard, plus Ruxandra Marquardt, violinist, Joel Bechtel, cellist and pianist Amy Greer, who are going to do a fantastic program of chamber music featuring Haydn, Fauré, and some other people. And that's going to be wonderful. And that will be live streamed from our sanctuary Thursday at noon. Hopefully you'll turn in and enjoy it while it's happening, but it will also be available to view afterwards. And again, one of the reasons we're doing those live stream concerts is to lift up the work of a wonderful organization that the music ministry here partners with. That's Albuquerque Healthcare for the Homeless. So as you're enjoying that concert on our YouTube channel, we hope that you will be inspired to donate to that fantastic organization. This is a big week going on because we have that concert coming up on Thursday. We had a live stream this past Thursday. We had Jazz Vespers on Saturday night. All of that is available to view, by the way. But we have been so looking forward to this upcoming Sunday when we are welcoming back a tremendous artist that we first had here at the very beginning of 2019. And when it looked like we were going to be able to produce live concerts on our Music at St. John's concert series on Sunday afternoons again, what we did in planning the season was we went back to people we'd had in recent years that we just loved having and wanted to have back. And the artist that we're having this week definitely falls in that category. Alcée Chriss is an internationally known concert organist. He was here first on Music at St. John's at the beginning of 2019. He'll be presenting a recital for us this Sunday at 2 o'clock in our sanctuary. You can enjoy that both live or by live stream. And by the way, he'll be a special guest in our worship service on Sunday morning as well. And he is joining me this morning from Middlebury, Connecticut. I think he's in Middlebury, Connecticut. That's where he lives. Welcome, Alcée Chriss.
Oh, man. How are you? I'm great. I don't want to get on and correct you immediately, but I live in Hamden, Connecticut.
You lived in Hamden, and people in Connecticut would be upset by that.
Well, no, I don't think they won't be upset. I just wanted you to know. It's so funny because Middlebury is very close to, sort of close to where I teach in Middletown. Yeah.
In Middletown. Oh man, I'm already completely messing this up.
No, so, like four different towns that start with middle, so don't even
start with middle.
Yeah, literally.
And I meant to mention why you're in Connecticut at all is that you are university organist and artist in residence at Wesleyan University, which I think happened since you were with us. Is that, I mean, how long have you been at Wesleyan?
Well, this is my third year at Wesleyan. I came there in July of 2019. So yeah, this is my third year. I'm up for reappointment. Here we go. I think I'll be okay. I think I'll be just fine. It's been a real wild ride at Wesleyan because, you know, that's my first official academic teaching position. So it's definitely a learning curve, but it's great to be able to reflect on where you came from and kind of where you're going as a teacher. And I think I finally in this third year started to feel like, oh, I really got this down to a science, and really starting to see those your students produce things like you wanted them to produce. It's just a really gratifying feeling working at Wesleyan. It's a really great place.
Yeah, I mean, Wesleyan has a great reputation, and everybody that I know that went to Wesleyan really loves Wesleyan. What has Wesleyan historically had a strong organ program?
Well, they've historically had strong organ scholarship. So Ronald Ebrecht was there for 30 years, who wrote the book on Duraflay. He's like the foremost, you know, expert on Duraflay's organ music. So yeah, the funny thing is that at Wesleyan, you can't necessarily study organ in a performance for a performance degree, but you can get a bachelor's of art in music studying organ, if that makes sense. It's kind of like Harvard and Yale, how they kind of offer that bachelor's of art of music but not the Bachelor's of Music. But it's really interesting because that means that we get to be very free. And you know how liberal arts colleges are. And it's really great because the interdisciplinary things that happen. We've had about 30 new compositions composed for the instruments through work, kind of connecting the graduate composition department, because we do offer a PhD in composition. So we've had some really interesting things to happen there with people just interacting with the organ in ways I hadn't imagined, always kind of pushing it to its limit a bit.
Very cool. So as I mentioned, you were with us a few years ago and we just had such a great time. We are thrilled you are coming back this week. I would love to know a little bit about your background, where you grew up, how you became an organist. Was it church for you, or how did you first encounter the instrument?
That's a great question. Well, that was like three questions though. So I'll try to hit them all.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so I was born in Dallas, Texas. I don't really remember ever living in Dallas, but I was born in Dallas. Then we moved to the suburbs of Fort Worth, Texas, to a small town named Burleson, Mansfield, Burleson, which are now huge towns in Texas. They're just suburbs of Fort Worth and Dallas. But you know, I grew up in church. My dad is a United Methodist minister. Actually, he went to SMU. So I grew up in the Methodist church, and my mother was a singer. She's an alto. My dad had drumming experience. And apparently, strangely enough, one of my great uncles was a concert pianist. So I think maybe somewhere in the line there's that music gene. As far as the organ, you know, I grew up, and I've told this story a million times. I feel like I'm a broken record, but I grew up with, you know, rinky dink pianos and Hammond organs. I mean, I grew up in the gospel tradition. We had a drum set. We had a bass player. We're very much in the, you know, Southern gospel tradition. That's what I grew up in. And so I think I kind of, you know, I got introduced to organs really through popular culture and folklore, you know, cartoons. And and of course, you know, they had the TBN, the Trinity Broadcasting Network. And this was always on in our house, 24/7.
Oh, Trinity, I remember, with the big hair and the giant
exactly.
Sets. Yeah, I remember
the Dolly
that.
Parton of Christians, you know. You know who I'm talking about. But yeah, they would have this. They would have these huge pipe organs on there, and I was just so enamored with it. I was so obsessed. But it seemed like a kind of far off dream, like it's something that would never really happen. It seemed a bit inaccessible because I was like, I never encounter these instruments. Uh-huh. I didn't really see a trajectory for myself where I would have ended up playing it. So I kind of, in a way, I guess I kind of forced the trajectory because I became so obsessed with. Once I started listening to organ recordings, that's really when it sold the deal. I was listening to Carl Richter's Bach album, I think, on repeat for months. Really, as a high schooler, I was that enamored with the sound world. And I think that's really what gave me that push. It's like, I want to be able to recreate this and get into that sound world. So maybe it was just a big nerdy project gone wrong.
And here I was am. About to use the word nerd. So I'm glad you used it. I'm glad
that's
you used mine. It first.
I wear it with honor.
There are some great organs in Dallas-Fort Worth. So did you eventually encounter some of those larger churches and some of those larger instruments?
You know, I'll say, you know, if you watch the documentary, you see I talk about how it was kind of tough to find a good teacher. But at the same time, I think sometimes I failed to recognize that I had a lot of people that were extremely generous with me in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. At First United Methodist, I forget the guy's name. I wish I remembered his name. I think it might be Tim White or something. But he gave me like access weekly to their main pipe organ, had no idea who I was. And that was a beautiful, beautiful instrument, First United Methodist of Dallas. My teacher gave me access to First Baptist of Dallas. I had a lot of opportunities to play instruments. I'm very thankful for that. You know, Dallas, of course, has a lot of money in their churches. And that kind of explains why they've really created kind of like a, it's a menu with everything on it. I mean, you can find every disposition sort of historical era in Dallas as far as organs. But of course,
you mentioned, go ahead.
I think it has a lot to do with SMU's, the Southern Methodist University's strong presence with Robert Anderson as a really important pedagogue. So people were coming into Dallas to study organ at a very serious level. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what kind of contributes to it. It's a blessing.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's the thing about organ, isn't it? It's an instrument you need access to. You need access to a room where the instrument lives, and that's more difficult than some other instruments, I would imagine. Mm-hmm. So did you go away as an undergraduate intending to major in music? Or?
Yeah, I was kind of all over the place my senior year. Give me just one second.
Yeah. Sorry. Alcée, as I believe this is going to be dinner time.
So. I'm so sorry.
It's so okay.
I feel like that guy with the kid in the background while he's on the government. You know what I'm, which video I'm talking about?
Yeah, I'm talking about it. Do you want me to play a video real quick?
Oh, no, I'm fine. No.
Okay. All right. So I was starting to ask, did you go to college intending to major in music?
Well, yeah, like I said, I was all over the place my senior year. I was considering not going to college for music. I was considering going for piano. But eventually I just landed on doing organ because it just made sense. I had gone to the Oberlin Summer Organ Academy the summer before I had to make college decisions. So it seemed pretty natural to me. I'll be honest with you, with how late I started the instrument, it was kind of a split second decision. You know what I mean? Because I didn't have a lot of time on the instrument. I had only played piano and it was kind of just like, okay, let's jump into the water with this.
Gotcha.
But I left Dallas, in 2010 and I haven't been back since. So I went to Oberlin for 5 years, got my bachelor's and master's. And then after that, I went to McGill for 4 years and I got my doctorate there. And I've been at Wesleyan for 3 years. There have been some church jobs in between and random gap years. I lived in Akron briefly and then in Orlando briefly, but that's pretty much where I've been.
And how were your parents with your career choice?
Oh, they were totally down. They saw that I was good at it. They respected it. And, you know, they're like, oh, he'll be playing in church. That's great. Just what we want.
That's right. He'll definitely have to spend time in church if he's going to be an organist. That's right. That's great. A moment ago, you mentioned the documentary, and I had planned to bring this up with you because the documentary you alluded to, I think, was released since you were here in 2019, but it's actually about an international organ competition in which you were a finalist back in 2017, if I'm not mistaken. And this is a fantastic documentary that was released on PBS. It's called Pipe Dreams. I want to give folks just a real quick taste of it. This is a 30-second trailer, and then we can talk about how you can watch the whole thing. Enjoy.
An even international organ competition.
It's like Olympic for organ.
Prizes amount to over $100,000.
Can you just slap me a little bit? No, literally, slap me, thank you.
I've never done this to myself before, put myself under this much pressure.
The final round's been haunting me at night.
I'm first Chinese competitor. I'm desperate to win this competition.
Pipe Dreams, part of Independent Lens on PBS.
Oh yeah, so, that's great. You picked one of the less embarrassing trailers. So
is that right? The first time we see you, you're asking somebody to slap you. So
that's not a joke at all. It's not even halfway a joke. It was not for the cameras at all. I'll do that to myself behind. It's almost like I have to wake up because I have horrible performance anxiety, even though I feel like I perform fine, but I still have performance anxiety, and often I have to literally, I can do jumping jacks, anything to just remind myself that I'm still kind of grounded and don't.
And in your body.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, that's an amazing documentary. It's just, it's a fantastic piece of work and you're one of the 5 stars of it. And so tell us, first of all, I would love to know kind of about the trajectory for a lot of concert organists involving competitions. And then in particular, I'd love to know about that competition and how it came about and all of that.
Sure. I mean, we're not, you know, organists aren't too unlike every other, you know, instrumentalist, but I think organists for some reason have a lot of competitions more than other instruments. I just don't hear about the same amount of competitions for other instruments. Cause I mean, organ competitions, they're sometimes 20, 25 a year and they're big prizes. And, you know, the thing is we have so many that sometimes it can get a little bit confusing about what matters and what doesn't matter. I think at the core, you know, of course, the big competitions come with these contracts where you get the manager and all these things. But I think more they're just an opportunity for people to be on a platform that seems to have some objectiveness to it. I know this sounds kind of silly, but this is at least how I thought about it. I thought about the fact that there weren't a lot of Black organists and not a lot of Black representation in the organ world. And I was like, okay, what's the quickest way to just put credentials on the table? And I figured, well, why not enter competitions? I didn't even think I was good enough to be in a competition. The first one I applied to, I think, was In fact, I did an organ. This is so funny. I did an organ competition when I was like 14. No, 16 years old. And yeah, I got my butt handed to me. It was horrible. It was terrible. I listened to those recordings back. It was god awful. But then in undergrad, I felt like I was doing a little bit better. I really applied to the competitions on my own, and they had my teachers to help me later. I didn't ask their permission at all. I just went for it. So the first one was Schweitzer, and I won it. So that was like, okay, well, fine. Then I did Miami, and I won that. And then I just kept doing them. And I just realized that a lot of this was really had a lot to do with programming yourself, more so than playing the best. I really started to develop myself as an artist through having to like be strategic about winning these competitions, because it was always the way I feel like I won the competitions was that I always programmed enough diverse repertoire that I could always show off something different with each piece. And I know most people do that, but I was very surgical about it, like down to like every little artistic sort of flower petal I wanted to open for each piece that I showed and what technical things I wanted to show. So that's kind of, I think, what won it for me at CIOC. I mean, I don't mean to say that I didn't practice or anything like that, but a lot of people gave me crap for my final my final round program. They said it was too eclectic, it was too versatile. But I mean, I guess it worked. Anyway, so to back up just a little bit. So the Canadian competition is four rounds long. There's a preliminary round, which is very grueling. It's a lot of repertoire they tell you to learn. And then you have a first round, which is all Bach and early music. And that's a tough round too. They knock out half the competitors there. I actually was ranked first there. I got the Bach prize for the first round. So that was fine. That's a tough round too, as I say in the documentary, because Bach is just like, it's so controversial. You can split the jury literally by playing a certain way, because there's even opinions there. Then the second round is on a big kind of Canadian romantic instrument, an SJB. And then the final round is in the Basilica in Montreal. And so each round, the amount of music goes up. It starts at 30 minutes, then 45 minutes, then a full hour. And it's quite grueling. And like I say, the programming is really the big question, because it really is. When you have five people all playing at the same level, you're going to probably ask, well, which program did I like the best? And you're going to lean that direction, I feel as if.
Yeah.
But I could be wrong.
That documentary, I mean, this must have been going on while the competition was going on. And I wonder if that was distracting at all. And I'm also curious to know how you felt about it when you finally saw it.
Oh, sure. Well, it's weird because they were following us for about 2 or 3 before the competition. They were following us for a while, and they followed multiple competitors that didn't even make it into the film. I mean, it was a huge operation. They were following, they were basically running across the globe, finding each organist at his point in time. So some of that footage is from years before the competition. Some of it is right at the competition. I didn't trust them at all at first. I didn't want them around. I didn't invite them to things because I was like, they were pushy, of course, because they wanted to get the footage. And so I was very suspicious of them. I kept them at bay. But over time, they really grew on me and I really opened up to them. Especially they came to visit and they came to a family gathering where we had Southern food and stuff, the whole camera crew, and they interviewed my whole family. And so we really got close with them. It was beautiful to see everything come together that way. But then, yeah, I didn't mind the documentary. I just hate the fact that you only see 1% of the footage. There's so much more footage of me just being a normal person. But it's like anytime I would say something funny, it's like, oh, let's get that. let's put that. Anything I say something sarcastic. Let me tell you, there's some person who apparently in a message board said that I was racist. Because remember, I said that there should be a black guy on the jury. It was a complete joke. Obviously, it's a joke. But somebody's like, this is racism, some Canadian message board.
Oh, man. Yeah.
I was like, oh, Lord, what have I got myself into?
Well, it's an amazing document. And I can only imagine as you get older and older to be able to look back on that is going to be something really, really special.
My hair recedes.
Yeah, that's right. No, I think it's very cool. So I have a couple of videos of you playing that I want to play. And the first is an example of an etude. And what would you tell us about this?
Well, this is interesting. You're going to get me started here. So first off, she's a composer who's well known. It's actually her 100th anniversary of her birth. Here is Jeanne Dimassou, Jeanne Demessieux. You know, she was the Dupre successor kind of for the virtuosic school of French organ playing. So these are just like, I don't want to call them unplayable, but they're basically these horribly unplayable etudes. Nobody wants to learn them. The most, you know, popular one is octaves, but they're very, very difficult. They're some of the most difficult organ works ever written. But they're also like, I think, technique builders, because if you can conquer them, they just increase your overall awareness of the instrument. Because they're so specific. It's not that they're impossible, but to execute them with precision, it just takes your technique and it just brings your, because technique at the end of the day is about, I think, spatial awareness and just like awareness of your fingers. So it really, it's like, I found every other organ piece to be easier after I played this piece you're gonna hear. Okay. And you know, of course, Demessieux, she premiered all six of these etudes at the same time. And they all have a technical point that they're doing. So they have octaves, which is the feet in octaves, tierces, the feet in thirds. And this is six, which is that they're always in a six. So it's kind of this weird carnival ride. It's the 6-8 kind of dance, but she has a very evil kind of snarky harmonic language. So sometimes it sounds like she's digging her nails into your head, but I think you watch the feet, you'll be entertained.
Yeah, I think it's very cool. And I'm gonna follow that immediately, if you don't mind. Sure. With the Foray, would you introduce that for us?
Sure. Foray is, of course, one of my favorite composers because I'm definitely a sucker for 1920s, you know, French impressionist sound. And he's kind of like pre-Durafle to me, pre-Durafle, pre-Dupre. I had to actually pick this work because I needed a lyrical work to play for the Longwood Gardens organ competition. And I had already known about this work, had been transcribed for organ, Pelléas et Mélisande, Foray's like incidental music to it. Which recording are you using? Do you mind me asking? The one from Longwood?
Yes, I believe it is. Yeah. So it's a huge instrument. Does that make sense?
Right. Yeah. Yes. So Longwood, this piece is all about showing dynamic range of the instrument. So the point of this is to show how you can use those swell boxes on the bottom. There's like six divisions. You use them kind of in tandem to get these crazy crescendos. So what we're going for here is kind of like these big swells, these waves that start slowly and get really big and come down. So all the drama, of course, is in Foray's harmony, but you really hear kind of like the tug and pull. You know, of course, the story is like there's a forbidden love in Pelléas, and then their lovers are murdered at the end. So you're always hearing these happy melodies that kind of have this tinge of, you know, tragedy to them. So it's a very beautiful prelude to a tragic story.
Yeah, I think it's gorgeous. So we're going to hear two things in a row. We're going to hear the Demessieux etude on sixths, and we're going to hear the Foray prelude for Pelléas et Mélisande. Enjoy.
Thank you.
Thanks Alcée for running Chriss those, playing, Matthew.
You're welcome. Alcée Chriss playing the prelude from Peleus and Melisande by Fauré. That is so beautiful.
Thank you. I appreciate it. It's the organ does the magic.
that's well, I was going to ask, that's an enormous instrument. And I mean, that just must be amazing to have that many colors at your fingertips to choose from.
Yes, if you're there for a concert, if you're there for a competition, it's extremely stressful to have that many colors to choose from. No, that's a notoriously difficult competition, because the Longwood Gardens organ is a huge instrument, and each of its stops has so much nuance that if you really don't know what every stop sounds like, you're at a huge disadvantage. Unlike most organs that have kind of like a very small set of 8-foot foundational tone, that entire organ is 8 foot. It has very few higher partials. So you have a lot of the stops with the same name with totally different characters. So it's a very, very interesting instrument. And yeah.
And where is this instrument? Where was that?
That's in Kennett Square. That's on the DuPont estate known as Longwood Gardens. It's the botanical gardens he built basically as a playground for himself and his friends. But they have an amazing organ there, and they had a famous organist by the name of Furman Schwinnen, who was there for years. And of course, Peter Conti, who's the organist at the Wanamaker, now presides over that instrument. It's an amazing instrument. If you ever get a chance to go there, definitely worth it. It's 10,010 pipes, I think, for a ballroom that seats 300 people. And I mean a tight 300 people. So you can really blow people out of there. It was designed to fill the whole sort of outdoor area leading up to the big ballroom. So yeah, definitely, if you get a chance to go to the competition, gosh, you really should. Mm. It's amazing.
And that must be one of the joys and challenges of the work that you do, is going around and playing different instruments and trying to figure out how to bring out their strengths and maybe sometimes cover up their weaknesses. That must be challenging too.
Probably that second part more than others. But yeah, you know, the funny thing is that you really do have to adapt each piece for each situation. And I think there was a time when I was younger where I was like, oh, it has to be this way. But these days, I've kind of just tried to ask myself what makes the instrument sound best, rather than being dictatorial. That I think that's the problem, of course, with going to study the organ a little bit, because you study in these situations where you generally have instruments that have all the resources you need. You're in a university with a custom instrument with this and that. Well, it's like, well, what do you do when you're on an organ and you want to play a good piece, but it doesn't necessarily have, you know, everything you need for it to be a proper performance? So yeah, it's been interesting. It really tests you, but it's also an opportunity to really kind of show what you can do with the instrument. I think that's kind of your job as the organist, is to definitely spend enough time with the instrument to get to know it. I mean, I know some concert artists, they go and they set it up and they say, okay, it's set. I pulled the stop that it said to pull. I'm good. The combinations are there, but I really do obsess over registration. I mean, I'll be fixing registrations up until the very last note if my ear detects something needs to be. But anyway, in any case, that's kind of my favorite part, to be honest with you, is setting everything up and really. And I remember at St. John's, you guys have a 3-manual instrument, right?
We do. We have a 3-manual instrument that's kind of interesting in that it's a Reuter. I mean, I know you've got the stop list and everything, but it was built for us and it was prepared for the organ we will eventually have. And so it's I'm sure it'll bring out all kinds of creativity for you.
Oh, I can't wait. No, it was a great time last time I was there.
I'm curious, because you are still, obviously, you're a performing concert artist and you are a professor at a university. You're still a church musician as well. And so has that been important to you all along your journey to keep those chops up and play services and choose music for parishes where you work and all that?
Well, you know, it's stable work and it's also work that I know very well. I find the problem is, of course, is that I'm very picky. So I usually want to be in charge. But then being in charge means I have to do a lot of other things than just play the organ and conduct the choir. So
are you saying you have control issues? Because I so relate to that.
What'd you say? I have what?
You have control issues?
Yes, I might say so. But the other thing is that I tell you, there are a lot of things that I am, but one thing I am not is an administrator. I've never pretended to be an administrator. So
gotcha.
Wow, Alcée, I haven't heard back from this email in 12 days. And I'm like, I'm doing my best. Just call me. And I just wish people would actually listen to me. I could take phone calls all day because I can take a phone call while I'm on the move to the next thing. But with email, I'm a notoriously bad emailer. So I put all my dirty laundry out there. You know, the thing is I really love worship and I really love being able to choose what I want. And especially in the Anglican tradition, which is my tradition now. Well, that's complicated. We could spend some time on that. Where I grew up, it was gospel music. But now I find myself in the Anglican tradition. We've been doing a lot of cool stuff there, actually, at the Anglican Church, St. Stephen's in Ridgefield. I just wrote a jazz mass, actually.
Cool.
Yeah. And so we premiered it at the church with a professional jazz big band from New York and Western Connecticut State University. And my amateur choir, lucky them, my amateur choir got to have this pop and jazz band behind them. They had a great time. They did a wonderful job.
I would love to take a look at that, seriously. And sure. The last time that you were here was over a weekend when we have a monthly jazz vesper mm-hmm. service, and you were a special guest at that.
That was so much fun. That was too much fun. Oh my God.
That leads me nicely into the last recording of yours that I want to play. This is actually not a video. This is an audio recording, mm-hmm. But this is an arrangement of T for Two. Tell us about this.
This is interesting. This is an ever-developing sort of piece because, you know, basically Art Tatum, there's this story, I think, that Art Tatum, was it Arthur Rubinstein, I think? Was it Art Tatum and Arthur Rubinstein? I don't want to say the wrong person, but I'm pretty sure it was Arthur Rubinstein. And they were doing this little piano off. And so Rubinstein, they were both playing T for Two, you know, Rubinstein played his version. And then apparently Art Tatum just sits down and just shreds for like 20 minutes. And apparently Rubinstein walks up to him and Tatum says something to the effect. He's like, oh, I could keep going. Do you want me to stop? So, I mean, the thing about it is, you know, the stride piano style, of course, the magic of the stride piano style is that you've got the fifth finger always catching the bass line to give the rhythm of the downbeats in the syncopation. And then you've got the thumb and the second finger usually hanging out a big stretch between a tenth. Sorry, there's my finger. So you're hitting the bass, right? And then it's jumping up to grab the tenor voices. The good thing about the organ is that you can take that fifth finger now with the pedal. The problem, of course, with the instrument is that a lot of the stuff that Tatum composed note for note is out of the range for the organ. So there's mm-hmm. a lot of stuff that's really Tatum shapes, but me improvising. So this version isn't really similar to any other version I've done. I mean, it's basically in its own right, it's kind of like cycling through a lot of Tatum's ideas because you learn them as cells, like these motivic cells. Uh-huh. And so sometimes I do get scared and get lost. I'm like, I don't remember what Tatum played here, but the motivic cells are so in the hand. And you sometimes realize when you hear his recordings, he'll have an idea and then his hand will kind of fly up the keyboard. And it's not like it's random notes. It's like a harmonic shape, but I'm starting to feel that a little bit where it's like when you're in the moment of improvisation, there are times where you don't exactly know what note you're going to play, but you're kind of in the shape of the harmonic gesture and you kind of just do a flourish. So you hear a lot of these kind of like Hammond organy jazz piano tendencies to it. But the other thing that was a big draw for me was Fats Waller's organ recordings. And so I kind of got a little bit of stylistic cues from him, which is, of course, much older and different than Tatum. But it kind of gives that kind of 1920s theater organ vibe. But it's definitely a little bit of everybody. I would not even call it Tatum these days. It has Tatum's skeleton, but it's filled with a lot of different things.
Okay, let's hear it. This is Alcée Chriss channeling Art Tatum and Fats Waller and who knows who else. This is T for Two. Enjoy. Thank you. That's just how
that's great fun.
So cool.
That's definitely great fun.
Is that stuff that you keep up, that style of improvisation on the organ? Is that something that you tend to do a lot?
That's funny because I've been adding some arrangements to the repertoire. I've been doing a lot more Oscar Peterson than Art Tatum these days. And some Chick Corea. I actually just did a half jazz piano, half organ concert recently, which was really rewarding. It was really rewarding because just the process of having to get my chops back together for it was really nice. I do a heck of a lot of transcription, like listening to recordings and learning them by ear, which is kind of the, but I also teach a lot of improv to my kids. So, you know, it's funny. It's like, I didn't spend a lot of time on improv when I was younger, but now these days that I've had to teach it, I've really been spending a lot more time with it. I do my Nosferatu now. So I do these big hour and a half long scare, you know, events accompanying silent film. I think in an alternative life, I'd probably be a theater organist.
That's very cool. I mean, it's kind of true, isn't it, that for classical instruments, it's really only organists that tend to be trained in improvisation.
It's true.
There's a great tradition really in organ improvisation, isn't there?
Because of the sacred music aspect, absolutely.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, Alcée, we are so looking forward to having you in Albuquerque this weekend, and we're so pleased that you made time for us. We were talking before we came on. I'd be curious to know what kind of lockdown has been for you and what it's been like as you're coming out of that, being back on the road.
Honestly, it's exhausting. I didn't realize what it was like to travel for concerts all the time. I'm like, ah! But I will tell you, I'm getting to a point now where I'm going to definitely try to do more freelance work. Mm-hmm. I think I'm going to make some, you know, career transitions in the next couple of years towards more freelance work so that traveling isn't so bad if you don't have anything keeping you at home. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And also just doing recording projects. So my next recording project is in University of Las Vegas, not too far from you, at Doc Rando Hall there in May. And, you know, as far as the pandemic, it was really a blessing. I got two salaried positions right before the pandemic hit. So I was really lucky. And I did a lot of audio engineering, a lot of choir recording, mm-hmm. a lot of composing. I did, you know, I started working on sketches of the Jazz Mass during the pandemic. And then I wrote two more movements this past, semester. It was tough with students for sure. That one semester where we didn't have in-person organ students was really tough. And I think on top of that, just, you know, the live stream concerts, it's all, you know, it's tough stuff. And honestly, I'll tell you, it's rough getting back, especially with the choir. It's tough getting back everybody back into the routine of intense music making because it's like a sport. It's like something you have to like practice to be churning the music. So in a lot of ways, it's gratifying because it's reminding me that I still got it. I'm still in shape. I can still handle it.
Yeah, I definitely relate to that. It's been hard coming back for so long out of the weekly rhythm that we're used to, especially as church musicians.
Yes.
Just trying to regain that again has been, I'm so grateful for it, but it's been challenging.
The community aspect. I think if we could all agree on that the community aspect that we were missing, that's the most joyful part. Playing with Montreal Symphony, just to be in the room, and just the atmosphere, I feel it. I can already feel myself tearing up just to have that experience of being back in the aura, in the spirit of music making. So I'm glad to come and I can't wait to play for you guys. I'm looking forward to it.
It's going to be great. Thank you so much for taking the time to do this today. We so appreciate it. It was great to get to know you a little bit and get a taste of some of the kind of stuff we're going to hear this weekend. And so you have a good week and you travel safe. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
We'll see you next weekend. Well, friends, Alcée Chriss is going to be with us in concert on Sunday afternoon at 2:00 Mountain Time. That'll be both live in the room and live streamed at home, and we hope that you will take advantage of that. And again, Alcée will be with us as a special guest in worship at our 11 a.m. service on Sunday morning as well. And then a reminder that we have a live stream recital Thursday at noon Mountain Time, some fantastic chamber music from Roxandra, Joel, and Amy. So I hope you'll tune in on our YouTube channel for that. Thank you so much for joining us today, and we hope to see you for all of that great music later in the week. Have a good week. Bye.